what I try to do with my team is to support cities in developing a long-term strategy to mitigate the risk of flooding. And particularly in the Global South, there are huge challenges for those cities. Those cities are expanding very rapidly. There's a lot of land use change around cities, resulting in erosion, resulting in floods. There is a poor quality in those cities in terms of temperature. Extreme weather events are making those cities more vulnerable. So my relation to the problem is that we want to help support cities in developing those strategies, and that's always an inclusive process. So we work with the stakeholders. And it has a long-term horizon, but also we're looking at the short-term needs and what needs to be done now to lessen the major problems. What we see is that it seems that the dynamics are going faster. For instance, in China, Chinese cities, they started, say, 10, 15 years ago with, say, 100,000 citizens, and now they have, some have over 5 million citizens. So what we see is that the dynamics seems to increase, so there is no time to reflect and to consider carefully what should be the next steps. Everything is going into a haste. And the same holds true for the Global South, the countries, the developing countries and cities in those developing countries. But what we try to do is to bring those cities together and to create a sort of network that those cities can learn from each other and also can co-create with each other and work on solutions for the future. One of the benefits is that systems, grey infrastructural systems, are not designed for exceedance. They are not designed for failure. And that means that if the systems are failing, the consequences of failing are often huge. The damage of failure are huge. Now, when we complement grey infrastructural systems with green systems, then we build in resilience. The systems are able to bounce back or even to recover quicker and have some extra capacity to dampen, say, the effects of extreme weather events or extreme stresses. So I think what is the transition, what is needed, that we slowly incorporate in the retrofitting and upgrading and maintenance schemes of grey infrastructure, green infrastructural systems. And that is a slow process because we cannot do that overnight. To replace a grey system by a green system is very expensive. But when we have an understanding when the lifetime of those systems are ending, we could anticipate and could say, okay, let's design the system in such a way that we enrich it with grey and green infrastructural components. One example which is close to my heart is Kendari, and it's situated in a bay. And upstream there are forests, tropical forests, and the people are cutting illegally the forest, resulting in erosion, and the erosion results in sedimentation in the river. And then when there is heavy rainfall in the catchment area, more frequent and devastating floods are occurring in that area. Now, what is being advocated there in Kendari is to develop a room for the river concept on the short term, which allows to create traps for the sediments, to collect the traps, and also downstreams to increase the area of mangrove forests. And the mangrove forests are now disappearing, of course, in that bay. But the plan is to reintroduce the mangrove forest, and that will also create a sort of green buffer around the city, which on the one hand protects the city against the storm surges, but also gives a better local climate. It will reduce the heat waves, and it will also absorb excess rainfall. So I think that is a beautiful example in the Global South, in Indonesia. Another example which is close to my heart is the Sponge City project in Kunshan. Kunshan is one of the vanguard cities in Sponge Cities in China. And there has now been implemented already, and that was realized in a very short time span, in only 2 years' time, large areas of urban agriculture. And the beauty of introducing urban agriculture in Chinese cities is that the citizens, the newcomers to those cities in China, have a rural background. And their parents were probably farmers, or most of them were farmers. So the citizens coming to those cities, they are very much inclined to spend time, their free time, which they will have more and more, on those urban agricultural land. Now, in that particular example of Kunshan, there's a private company who is managing the urban agricultural plots. And that company is supporting the service to the citizens to grow their own crops. They have equipment, they have the knowledge how to do that. So they will support the citizens to have their own plot and to produce their own fruit and vegetables. So I think that is also a very nice example of nature-based solutions.